So, how are you guys doing?
Good, thanks.
Yeah. How's it being in the UK?
Glorious. This city is magical. I've always wanted to live here. I also found out from my 23andMe that I'm really British. So I feel like I've come to the homeland.
Did it say on your 23andMe, really British?
It did.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah, I'm like 70% or something crazy.
Did that happen to you too?
Yeah. 100% just British me.
Really British.
Cool, so you obviously performed this back in 2017. Are you looking forward to performing it back together again in the summer?
We are just
ecstatic.
Well, we're truly honored to be coming to London to share this masterpiece with a theater community that not only cares about theater in a way that's active, but also there's just such support here for theater financially. You show up. It's incredible. So we're just honored to share the piece.
Yeah, so you're looking forward to kind of bringing it to the West End from Broadway. How is that going to be, bringing it to London?
There's nothing like this show. I mean, there's nothing like performing this show, and I don't think there's any real experience like this show. I'm going to say, hands down, on the West End, and really ever, they wrote a show that is unmatched. And I think we're back again doing it because we haven't quite wrestled it to the ground, you know? It is just constantly changing and constantly evolving. It is a show about process, and it's unfinished for us. And so we're gonna try our best again to finish it up. And there's no better place for us than here on the West End.
Were you kind of involved in the conversation of bringing it to the West End? When did you kind of find out about those plans of the transfer?
Well, when the lights went out on the last song of the show, when we did it on Broadway, we just whispered to each other, "See you on the West End," right? And then that was it. I mean, that was it. No, I mean, there were conversations about it because even when we were doing the show, we wanted to continue it. We had a short run because we had the theater for a short period of time. And we had done it in a sort of whirlwind when we first did it. We had done a concert of it, and then that was so successful it was that we moved it to Broadway within a few months, you know. That was a mad rush, and so everything was done so quickly. When we got to the end, we were like, oh, we were just at the beginning.
I remember being in previews, and James Lapine came on stage at one point to change something, and he was like, oh, I can't change it because we can't change the lights. And he looked at me and he went, I'll do it in London.
Amazing. So can you kind of like tell us a bit about your characters and the relationships and obviously the differences between Act 1 and Act 2?
It's a show that spans 100 years. And the show begins in the 1880s, where George Seurat, who I play in the first act, is starting to paint his very famous painting, the Grand Jatte, the pointillism painting that we all have come to know. And his subject, who is his lover and named Dot, aptly named, obviously, because his paintings are all made of dots. And the first act is really their about their love and their love affair and him painting the painting and the irreconcilable differences that they have. And the second act is takes place 100 years later in 1983, and his great-grandson and his, who I play, also named George, and his daughter, who Annaleigh plays, who's 98. His grandson, great grandson, is an artist who's very successful, but is not fully satisfied with the art that he's making. And his grandmother imparts a lot of wisdom on him. And the second act is about sort of the creation of a family, ultimately, and that is its own work of art.
And how is it kind of playing those contrasting characters? Is it hard to switch from between the kind of roles?
Both of mine have a beard, so it works fine. Yeah, it's difficult.
I have one of the fantasies of my lifetime, getting to play a 90-year-old woman. I mean, I've been trying to do that since I was 5. Been
me
playing
too.
Old ladies. For me, it's there's a great physical transformation that I have to make with the character. But it's such an honor. It's just truly a gift.
So finally, the show is called Sundays in the Park with George. What is your ideal way to spend a Sunday?
In the park with George.
Nice. Get that plug in.
Oh, we're going to have Sunday off.
No, we're London. Not going to have Sunday. Oh, we are going to have Sunday off. Yes, in London.
Yes, we're going to have Sundays off in London. And in the States, we
Sundays
have one
off
matinee
in the park
on
with
Sundays.
George. Sundays off in the park.
You can practice your Britishness.
I have a feeling that might become a difficult thing for people to understand, because they're going to be like, it's called Sunday in the Park with George, we'll go on Sunday.
And we'll never sing Sunday on Sunday here.
No, we won't. Oh, that's weird. That's true. Unless we're like doing something for the show where we're singing Sunday on Sunday.
Which doesn't seem likely.
Sunday on Sunday. It's like Sondheim on Sondheim.
Is it a new, we're going to do a new
review. Just stick around. We're going to talk nonsense, so just don't feel free to, like, you don't have to ask questions.
I'm
just
still in my
fever watch
dream.
Us lose our minds next to each other.